Today we'll discuss the effect of placing a dielectric between the plates of the capacitor, and obviously we get an advantage of an increased capacitance, so that is the reason why we are using a dielectric. Say we have a capacitor over here, and this is an air cored capacitor because there is air between the two plates of the capacitor, and now we introduce a dielectric slab into this capacitor. So which means that we fill the space between the plates with a dielectric material. Now, what is a dielectric material? See, a dielectric material is a non-conducting material, and some of the commonly used dielectrics are glass, polyethylene, mica, mylar, etc. Now let's say the dielectric is introduced and it completely fills the space between the plates. Now the capacitance of this capacitor increases by a factor of K. So originally when there was only air between the plates of the capacitor, let's say the capacitance was C naught, and now when we introduce the dielectric, the capacitance becomes K times C naught. This K over here is the dielectric constant of this material. See, I'll give you some values of dielectric constants just to give you an idea how much the capacitance can change. Say we have glass, polyethylene, mica. Now the dielectric constant for glass varies between 5 to 10. For polyethylene it is about 2.25, and for mica it is between 3 to 6. Say you have a capacitor over here. Now if you introduce a glass dielectric into it, its capacitance will increase 5 to 10 times depending on the particular choice of glass. If you introduce polyethylene into this, the dielectric, the capacitance will increase 2.25 times, and if you introduce mica, the value will increase between 3 to 6 times. Now incidentally, the dielectric constant for vacuum is 1, and for air it is almost 1. Now the value for vacuum being 1 is the way the dielectric constant is defined. So we'll just look at that point also a little later. Now you might be wondering that why does the capacitance increase when you introduce a dielectric into it? So let's just take a look at this. We'll just look at this first in terms of the formula. Now when the dielectric is introduced, the electric field between the plates of the capacitor reduces. Say this is the original electric field. Say let's say this has a positive charge of plus Q and this has a negative charge. Now on introducing the dielectric, the charge is not going to change because this is not connected to a battery. Now originally the electric field was E naught, and now on introducing a dielectric, the electric field reduces, and the electric field reduces by a factor of the dielectric constant, so it becomes E naught by K. Now this means the original potential difference V naught was equal to E naught times D. This is the old potential difference, and now the new potential difference is E times D. The new electric field is E, so this is E times D, which is equal to E naught by the dielectric constant K, this is also called kappa, times D. Now if you look at the capacitance, the old capacitance can be written as Q by E naught times D, because it will be Q by V, and the new capacitance is Q by E times D, and which is E naught by K times D, which becomes K times Q over E naught D, and you can see that this is the old capacitance. This is the old capacitance. So now we finally get that the new capacitance is kappa times the dielectric constant times the old capacitance. So what we are saying here is that on introducing the dielectric, the electric field decreases, and since the electric field decreases, the potential difference decreases, and since the potential difference decreases, the capacitance increases. Now let's see first of all, why did the electric field decrease? So let's take a look at this a little more in detail, that why did the electric field decrease on introducing a dielectric between the plates of the capacitor. Now let's say these are the two plates of the capacitor, and one has a positive charge and the other has a negative charge. Now when you place this dielectric between the plates, then the material gets polarized. Now what do we mean by the word polarized? See, we can have two kinds of dielectrics. One is a polar dielectric and the other is a non-polar dielectric. A polar dielectric is one in which tiny dipole moments already exist in the material. So you have these tiny dipoles, a positive and a negative charge, which are separated, equal and opposite positive and negative charge separated by a small distance. But the material doesn't have a resultant dipole moment because these are all randomly oriented. And since they're randomly oriented, and they're randomly oriented due to thermal agitation, so they cancel out the effect of each other. So the material as a whole does not have a dipole moment. Now, some examples of polar molecules are water and HCl. Maybe you can brush up a little bit of your chemistry and check why are these molecules polar. Now, in the presence of an external electric field, these dipoles get aligned along the electric field. So, this is a positive and a negative charge. So these dipoles get aligned along the electric field. See, earlier they were all randomly placed. Now they are aligned along the electric field. Now let's say the medium is nonpolar. In case it is nonpolar, which means that the centers of the positive and the negative charge of the molecules coincide exactly. So they have a net zero dipole moment. Now when such a material is placed in an external field, say this non-polar material is placed in an electric field, then dipoles are created. Dipoles are created due to charge separation. So we have little tiny dipoles which get created because the centers of the positive and the negative charge are not coinciding with each other. So we have these tiny dipoles which get created. Now once these dipoles are created, and since you have an external field, these dipoles will also get aligned along the field, just as in the case of polar molecules. So whether you have a polar material or a non-polar material, you finally have dipoles which align along the electric field. So the final effect is, this is the electric field and these are the dipoles which are aligned along the electric field. Now let's take a look at the magnified view of the dielectric. You have these little dipoles over here, and these are aligned along the electric field. Since the electric field is in this direction, the dipoles are aligned with the negative ends here and the positive ends over here. So these ends are negative, these are positive. And similarly, this end would be positive and this would be negative. Now, this dielectric effectively behaves like a layer of negative charge over here. All these negative charges which you're going to find in these dipoles over here, and a layer of positive charges which you see over here. So now we can draw the electric field as, these are the two plates of the capacitor. So we have a layer of negative charge, which is the induced charges over here. These are the original charges on the plates of the capacitor. This is the original charge on the plates of the capacitor, and these are the induced charges. Now, the original field was E naught, and now, which is equal to sigma by epsilon naught. And now the field due to the induced charges is sigma I over epsilon naught. This charge density was sigma, and this charge density is sigma I. Sigma I, the induced surface charge density, is less than sigma. It is not equal to it. It is less than it. So this, the new electric field, is sigma I over epsilon naught. The final field, see, the original field was in this direction. The field due to these induced charges, you can see, since these are positive and these are negative, is in this direction. And the final field, which is the difference of these two fields, will be in the downward direction. The final field is in this direction. So if we label this as E naught, the original field, EI is the field due to the induced charges, and E naught minus EI is the final field after the dielectric is introduced. Now this field, which is E naught minus EI, which is the vector sum of the two fields, is equal to the original field E naught over the dielectric constant kappa. This means the electric field decreases kappa times, and as we discussed earlier, if the electric field decreases kappa times, which means V decreases kappa times and C increases kappa times. Let's just briefly summarize the main points that we covered today. First of all, a dielectric is a medium, is a non-conducting material that is introduced to increase the capacitance of a capacitor. And some commonly used dielectrics are glass, polyethylene, mica, etc. When the dielectric is introduced and it completely fills the space between the plates, the capacitance increases dielectric constant times. So the dielectric constant K is C over C naught. See, we've been saying it completely fills the space. If it doesn't completely fill the space, then the calculation is a little different. In our next lesson, we'll discuss a numerical problem where the dielectric doesn't completely fill the space between the plates. When the dielectric is introduced between the plates of the capacitor, the electric field decreases by a factor of K. This implies that V also decreases by a factor of K, and hence C increases by a factor of K. If the material is a polar medium, then dipoles already exist in the material, but they are randomly oriented at room temperature. If the medium is non-polar, then first dipole moments get created, and then they align themselves along the electric field. The final electric field is the original electric field minus the field due to the induced dipole moments. The original field is sigma over epsilon naught, and the induced field is sigma I over epsilon naught, and this is equal to sigma over dielectric constant. Sigma by epsilon naught over the dielectric constant. So due to this, the electric field decreases and V decreases and C increases.